welcome back to another lecture of Dental Pathshala, where we help you understand and learn dentistry better and easy way. And today's video is a continuation of Express Revision course for orthodontics. So if you want to watch more interesting videos like this, go to the playlist. In that you'll find more interesting videos. And now you don't have to take down the notes. You will find in the description below there is a link, and that will take you to the notes of this particular video. And also you can find more interesting notes in www.x2.com. So let's get started with the today's topic of occlusion. And before we get started, make sure you subscribe to the channel and click on the bell icon so that you don't miss any of our future notifications, future videos. So guys, starting with the occlusion, we'll be only talking about the important points which are required for our competitive exam. So first one is the pre-normal occlusion. What do we mean by pre-normal occlusion? See, there are two terms. One is the pre-normal occlusion and the other term is the post-normal occlusion. So what do we mean by both of them? Pre-normal occlusion is class 3 occlusion. We know that class 3 is genetic, so it is easy for us to remember. In that, mandible is forward when the path of mandible closure is in the forward in the centric occlusion. So suppose this relationship was the centric occlusion. So now it is forward. The mandible is forward. So preward is there. Always I told you in the last video also that we have to only look at the mandible. So this is the pre-normal. Post-normal occlusion is our class 2 occlusion. So if we talk about pre-normal occlusion, if they are confusing with the question, so pre-normal occlusion is the class 3. There are two ways to remember is. One way is you can look at the mandible. Other way is when you look at the genetic factor. So pre is when the mandible is forward, that means the class 3. Or the another way you can remember it, the genetic is hereditary genes, right? So that is class 3. So the another term or also important that can be the deep bite or increase over bite, right? We know these terms. Deep bite is when there is excessive vertical overlap in the anterior teeth. So this is going to be the deep bite. Here is the deep bite. Suppose this was the normal case. This was the normal case. Now if you can look at the bite, the vertical bite we are talking about, the vertical overlap here is increased. So this is a deep bite or increased over bite. The next terminology we have is the open bite. Now there are two things. One is the deep bite, another one is the open bite. Open bite is when there is no vertical overlap which is present. So an open bite can be like this. So if you can see here, there is no vertical overlap. So no vertical space which is present. So this is our open bite, or it can be open also. So mandibular teeth can be open also like this, starts from here. So there can be gap also which may be present. So spacing can be present in case of open bite or no vertical overlap which can be present. So talking about the angles classification, which we know already, right? But still there are questions which can be asked from angles classification. So angles classification, we have got three classes: class 1, class 2 and class 3. Class 1 angles, starting with the class 1. So class 1 is when the mesiobuccal cusp of the maxillary first molar. So this is the maxillary teeth. We are talking about the 6th one, which is the first molar, coincide with the buccal groove of the mandibular first molar. So here is the buccal groove of the mandibular first molar. So there is going to be a normal interarch molar relationship in case of class 1 angles, class 1, right? So the mesiobuccal cusp of the maxillary first molar coincide with the mesiobuccal groove of the mandibular first molar. Now there is something known as bimaxillary protrusion. What do we mean by bimaxillary protrusion? Bimaxillary protrusion, as the name suggests, I always tell you to look at the name first. As the name suggests, both the sides, right, there will be protrusion which is present. So if we look at the anterior teeth, the anterior to be proclined here. So the anterior teeth are proclined, maxillary anteriors are proclined here. So protrusion is present in maxillary anterior teeth. But in case of bimaxillary protrusion, there is going to be a normal interarch molar relationship which is present. That means the mesiobuccal cusp of the maxillary first molar coincide with the buccal groove of the mandibular first molar. So that means the molar relationship in bimaxillary protrusion is class 1 molar relationship, but the anterior teeth are proclined or protruded in case of bimaxillary protrusion. Now talking about the class 2. So class 2, difference between class 1 and class 2 is, class 2 what happens, there is going to be anterior proclination, that we know. And also one more thing we know, that the molars will be more distally, right? And this is the reason we call it distoocclusion also, we will talk about it. So the distobuccal groove, now we are not talking about, this is the mesial side, this is the distal side. Here also, this side is the mesial side, this side is the distal side, and this one is the mesial side, then the distal side. So in class 2 malocclusion, class 2 angles classification, the distobuccal groove is going to coincide with the distobuccal cusp of the maxillary first molar coincide with the buccal groove of the mandibular first molar. So this is the difference. In class 1 it is the mesial cusp, in class 2 it is the distobuccal cusp. So mesiobuccal cusp means class 1, distobuccal cusp means class 2, and this is the reason we call it distoocclusion. So easy to remember. So in class 2 we have two divisions, division 1 and we have division 2. So here we have distobuccal cusp coinciding with the distobuccal cusp of the maxillary first molar coinciding with the buccal groove of the mandibular first molar. This is the class 2 malocclusions, angles class 2 malocclusion. So we have two divisions, right? Class 2 division 1 and class 2 division 2. Let's have a look at class 2 division 1 first. Division 1. So in the angles class 2 division, see the difference between angles class 2 division 1 and division 2 is that division 1, there are proclined upper anterior teeth. Proclined upper anterior teeth. But if we look at class 2 division 2, okay, let's just make a table so that it is easier for us to compare both of these. So the difference between class 2 division 1 and class 2 division 2 is that in class 2 division 1 there are proclined upper incisors. So proclined upper incisors teeth. And if we look at class 2 division 2, then see central incisor and lateral incisor both are different. See in class 2 division 1 there are proclined upper incisors. That means both the incisors are tipped labially, right? So both the incisor are basically labially tipping, labially. If we look at the class 2 division 2, so central incisors are lingually tipped, but on the other hand the lateral incisors are labially tipped. So this is the main difference between class 2 division 1 and class 2 division 2 clinically. If we look at clinically, and also we see in class 2 division 1 there is a deep overbite which is seen in the anterior teeth, right? And there is abnormal, and in case of class 2 division 2 we have deep anterior overbite, but this is more prominent in case of class 2 division 2. So this is important feature for class 2 division 2, which is the anterior overbite which is deep. Also, we see that there is a abnormal muscle activity which is seen in class 2 division 1, and also we see there is a lip trap. So how this lip trap is formed? There are upper lip are hypotonic, so there is a upper lip which is short, upper lip which is short and hypotonic, short and hypotonic and hypotonic. And because of this, it fails to form a lip seal. So there is a failure of lip seal. And the tongue occupy the lower posture and fail to counteract the buccinator activity. So that is the reason that it result in the narrowing of the upper arch. So there is a narrow upper arch at the premolar and the canine area. And this is the reason that we see V-shaped palatal arch in case of patients with class 2 division 1. And there is a hyperactive mentalis. And guys, class 2 division 2, we see that the central incisors are lingually tipped, but the lateral incisors are labially tipped. But in case of class 2 division 1, there are labially tipped anteriors. So we see that there is a deep anterior overbite, which is a classical feature for class 2 division 2, and it is important. So the mandibular labial tissues get traumatized. And the reason for that is due to the excessive tipping of the upper central incisors. And if you see in case of class 2 division 2, there is normal perioral muscle activity. If you remember, in case of class 2 division 2, division 1, we have studied that there is an abnormal muscle activity. As you can see, in case of class 2 division 1, we see that there is an abnormal muscle activity, but in case of class 2 division 2, there is a normal muscle activity. So this is a differentiating feature for both of them. So as you can see here, abnormal muscle activity in class 2 division 1, but normal muscle activity in class 2 division 2. So talking more about class 2 division 2, there is excessively tipped central incisors, and because of that, the patient can develop abnormal backward path of mandibular closure. Right. So these are the features for class 2 division 1 and class 2 division 2. I hope that you guys are clear with the class 2 division 1 and 2. So in the class 2 division 1, there is labially tipped upper anterior teeth. But in case of class 2 division 2, the central incisors, they are tipped lingually, but the lateral incisors, they are tipped labially. Right. So also there is something known as subdivision. So we also have class 2 subdivision. What do we mean by subdivision? So subdivision is wherein one side, that means either can be left side or the right side, one side there is a class 1 molar relationship, angles class 1 molar relationship, and the other side is class 2. Now this class 2 can be division 1, it can be division 2. So talking about class 3 malocclusion. So in the class 3 malocclusion, now there is going to be the mandible, there can be mandible which is forwardly placed. That means, if you remember, this is the maxillary first molar. Right. This is the mesiobuccal cusp. This one is the distobuccal cusp. So for class 1, the mesiobuccal cusp coincide with the buccal groove of the mandibular first molar. For class 2, the distobuccal cusp of the maxillary first molar coincide with the buccal groove of the mandibular first molar. Right. So in case of class 3, what do we have here? We have the both the it is between both the molars. So both the molars, this is 6 for, I have supra erupted it. So guys, so basically the mesiobuccal groove is going to come between both the molars. So this is the mesiobuccal groove. Now, so mesiobuccal cusp of the maxillary first molar coincide with the first and the second mandibular permanent molar. So this is the class 3 malocclusion. Class 3 malocclusion can be pseudo or it can be a true class 3 malocclusion. So what do we mean by pseudo class 3? Pseudo class 3 is also known as postural or habitual. That is the reason we are calling it pseudo. So it can be due to the posture. That means the path of closure for the mandible is such a way that it seems like a class 3, but it is not actually a class 3. So it is a habitual class 3, right? So because of the occlusal prematurities, there can be a forward path of mandibular closure. So forward path of mandibular closure. So other reason, one is the occlusal prematurities. Other reason can be the premature loss of deciduous posterior teeth, loss of primary posteriors. In order to establish a contact in the anterior region, so the patient is taking the mandible forward while closing the mandible. So in order to establish anterior tooth contact, there is a forward mandibular closure. Or there can be enlarged adenoids. And the reason for that is, see, in case of enlarged adenoids, because the patient is preventing the tongue to contact the adenoids, so in order to prevent the tongue from contacting the adenoids, the patient is taking the mandible forward. So there is a forward path of mandibular closure, and these are the reasons for the pseudo class 3 we have. It can be the occlusal prematurities, it can be the premature loss of the primary posterior teeth, and can be the enlarged adenoids. And all of them are going to result in the forward mandibular path of closure. This is not actually class 3. The skeletal or the dental relation is not class 3. The molar relation is not class 3. The molar relation is normal. But the patient is taking mandible forward. So this is the reason we call it pseudo class 3, right? So next one is the true class 3. True class 3 is genetic. So true class 3 malocclusion, that is class 3 molar relation we are talking about, wherein the mesiobuccal cusp of the maxillary first molar coincide the both the molars, both the mandibular molars, so the 6 and the 7. So guys, the true class 3 molar relationship is genetic. And in case of true class 3 molar relationship, we see that the lower incisors are lingually tipped, inclined or lingually tipped. Lingually inclined. Because we see that in the true class 3 relationship, there can be edge to edge relationship. Edge to edges, wherein this is the maxillary anterior, then the mandibular anterior can be either edge to edge, or there can be the mandibular anterior can be in the cross bite also. So there can be either edge to edge or there can be anterior cross bite seen in the true class 3 molar relationship, in the true class 3 malocclusion. And we see that there is a normal overjet which is present. And more tongue space is there, so therefore tongue occupy the lower position, and this is the reason that we see there is a narrow upper arch in case of class 3. So these are the class 1, 2 and 3 angles molar relationship. Now there are keys of normal occlusion, which are the Andrews 6 keys of normal occlusion. So Andrew 1970 put 6 keys to the normal occlusion with the ideal occlusion, and the presence of these 6 factors, they are essential to achieve the optimal occlusion. So these are the molar interarch relationship, the mesiodistal crown angulation, the labiolingual crown inclination, absence of rotation, tight contacts, presence of tight contacts, and the curve of spee. So these are the Andrew's 6 keys of normal occlusion. Also we have a new one, 7th key of occlusion, which is the Bolton's ratio. So Bolton's tooth ratio is the 7th key of occlusion, right? So these are the Andrew's 6 key of occlusion. Now we have some syndromes associated with the class 2 and class 3 division malocclusion. So syndromes, let's talk about first class 2 syndromes associated with the class 2 malocclusion. So we have syndromes like Perry-Robbins syndrome, Perry-Robbins. We also have mouth breathing habit. We also have ankylosis of condyle. Now I know that you must be wondering, this is so difficult to remember all of these syndromes, and what if one of the syndrome has been asked as a question. So I have a mnemonic for you guys, which is PMAM. Whether it is PM or it is AM, it is still the good morning, right? So good morning. So how are we going to remember it? P is equal to Perry-Robin, M is equal to mouth breathing, then we have A is equal to ankylosis of condyle, then we have got M, again M, which is our Milwaukee braces. Also we have one more M, which is the mandibulofacial dysostosis, which is also known as the Treacher-Collins syndrome, mandibulofacial dysostosis. Dysostosis, also called as Treacher-Collins syndrome, right? Next, now PMAM. Still, then we have got still as it is, which is our, still is our Still's disease. Still's disease, right? And we have G and M. We have to take G from good, M for morning. So G and M. So for G it is Golden Heart syndrome, and for M is the Mobius syndrome. So these are the syndromes which are associated with the Class 2 malocclusion. PM AM, still good morning. So P perirobin, M mouth breathing, ankylosis of condyle, mandibulofacial dysostosis, Stinson and golden heart syndrome and Mobius syndrome. Then we have the syndromes which are associated with class 3 malocclusion. So the syndrome which are associated with class 3 malocclusion, you can remember from the mnemonic, God help us to hack 3 MAC. So G O D. From G is the Gorlin syndrome. O is our osteogenesis imperfecta. Osteogenesis imperfecta. D is the Down syndrome. So the Down syndrome. Then hack. Again H-A-C-K. Let's write hack. H-A-C-K. So hack is our H for we have is the hyperpituitarism. A is our achondroplasia. C is our Crescens disease or the craniofacial dysostosis. Then K is our Klinefelter syndrome. 3, you can remember it from class 3. And M is our Marfan syndrome. So these are the syndromes which are associated with a class 2 malocclusion. So class 2 malocclusion, we have PM AM, still good morning. So P for perirobin, M for mouth breathing, A for ankylosis, M is the Milwaukee braces, or you can remember mandibulofacial dysostosis, which is the Treacher Collins, still is the Still's disease. G is the golden hair syndrome, M is the Mobius syndrome. Then we have the class 3 malocclusion. So class 3 malocclusion, you can remember God hack 3 MAC. Right. So G for Gorlin, O for osteogenesis imperfecta, D is the Downs, H is the hyperpituitarism, A chondroplasia, then Crescens or the craniofacial dysostosis, Klinefelter and the Marfan syndrome. So these are the syndromes which are associated with the class 2 malocclusion and the class 3 malocclusion. So guys, let's talk about some other malocclusions, some other classifications, such as Dewey's classification, Dewey's modification of the Angle's malocclusion. So in that, the Angle malocclusion, Angle class 1 and the class 3, they have got subtypes. So class 1 modification, class 1 Dewey's modification for the Angle's malocclusion is type 1. So in that, type 1 is the class 1 malocclusion with the crowding, and class 2 is, type 2 is class 1 malocclusion with maxillary incisors protrusion. Type 3 is Angle's class 1 malocclusion with anterior crossbite. Type 4 is Angle's molar relationship with the posterior crossbite. And the type 5 is class 1 molar relationship has drifted now. So drifted malocclusion, permanent molar relationship due to the early extraction of the E. So because of the early extraction of the second deciduous molar, or it can be due to the second premolar. So because of that, the permanent molars have drifted mesially. So this is the Dewey's modification for class 1. The Dewey's modification for class 3 is, the type 1 is wherein if we look at the upper and the lower alignment of the teeth, they are normal. So the normal upper and lower alignment is there. But when the arches are occluded, then what do we see? We see that there is an edge-to-edge relationship, edge-to-edge incisor relationship, and this is suggestive of the forward movement of the mandible. So forward, edge-to-edge relationship of the maxillary anterior teeth or the incisors, which can be due to the forward movement of the mandibular dental arch. So type 2 is, the mandibular incisors, they are crowded and they are in lingual relationship. So these crowded are the mandibular teeth, right? And they are in lingual relationship, the maxillary incisors. Type 3 is when the this is the mandibular, right? The maxillary incisors are crowded and they are in crossbite relationship to the mandibular anterior teeth. So this was the Dewey's modification for the angle small occlusion. Also we have Lischer modification for the angles class small occlusion. So in that he has given some other terms for small occlusion, such as the neutro occlusion. So neutro occlusion is basically our class 1 malocclusion. So class 1 malocclusion. Disto occlusion, we have talked about this. When we are talking about the mandible, disto occlusion is when there is a class 2 malocclusion. So that means the mandibular molar have drifted distally or shifted distally. Then we have mesio occlusion. Mesio occlusion is for the class 3. Then we have bucco occlusion. So bucco occlusion means when the teeth are placed buccally. Then we have lingual occlusion. That means the teeth are placed lingually, right? Then we have supra occlusion. So supra occlusion, suppose this is the plane of the occlusion. So when a tooth have erupted beyond the normal occlusion, suppose it was supposed to be like this. This is the occlusal plane. So if the tooth have erupted beyond the normal level of the occlusion, so that is the supra. Infra is opposite of supra. That means below the occlusal plane. Suppose this was the occlusal plane. So if it is below the occlusal plane, it is infra occlusion. Also we have like this mesioversion. So mesioversion is a term used for mesial to the normal position. Then we have transversion. Transversion is when there is a transpositioning of the two teeth. And also we have like this distoversion. That means distal to the normal position. Also we have exiversion. Exiversion is when there is abnormal inclination of the tooth. Also we have torsiversion. That means rotation. Torsiversion means rotation around its axis. So rotation of the tooth around its axis. So guys, let's talk about the Simon's classification. We have the Simon's classification. So he said malocclusion can occur in anterior posterior direction, transverse or in vertical plane. So guys, this Frankfurt horizontal plane is our elatragus plane. So this is the elatragus plane, right, where the Frankfurt horizontal line is there. So this is a horizontal plane and we have got two terminologies. One is the attraction, another one is the abstraction. Attraction is the one which is closer. Abstraction means away. So if it is closer to the Frankfurt horizontal plane, when the dental arch or a part of it is closer to the Frankfurt horizontal plane, it is known as attraction. When the dental arch is farther away from the Frankfurt horizontal plane, we call it abstraction. So the next plane we have is the orbital plane. Orbital plane is a plane which is perpendicular to the horizontal plane. So if we are talking about orbital plane, that means this is a vertical plane, right? So this plane passes through the distal upper third of the canine area. So this is a plane which is going to pass through the upper third of the canine area. So one second, guys. So like this. So it is a vertical plane passing through the upper canine area. So in the orbital plane, we have two terms. One is the protraction. Another one is the retraction. So first of all, because it is passing through the canine area, so we call it the Simon's law of canine. So if it is more posterior, see, there are two terms, protraction and retraction. If it is posterior to the plane, it is retraction, and the opposite is protraction, right? So the third plane we have is the mid-sagittal plane. So mid-sagittal plane, we know a plane which is passing through the midline. So this is a plane which is passing through the midline is the mid-sagittal plane. So mid-sagittal plane also we have two terms. One is the contraction. So contraction is closer. The other term is the distraction. Distraction is the away. So this is our Simon's classification. So guys, next we are going to talk about the habits. Habit is just an act of doing or performing a repeated act. That means if a person is repeatedly doing some action, so that becomes a habit, right? So if I am doing workout every day, or if I am studying every day, that makes a habit. But habit here is a tendency. It is basically a fixed consistency performance, repeated performance, right? So habit, we are going to talk thumb sucking. Either it can be thumb sucking or it can be digit sucking. So basically what happens, a child is going to suck the thumb. So suppose this is the maxillary teeth, upper teeth, and what happens is a child sucks the thumb, right? So, and these are the lower teeth. So thumb sucking habit is normal in children up to the age of 3 to 4 years. So 3.5, we can say 3.5 to 4 years, this habit is normal. But after that, this habit becomes abnormal. So there are some effects which we see in the thumb sucking habit. What are the effects which we see? So these effects are based on FDI. What is FDI? So these effects are seen based on the frequency. That means the number of times a patient is sucking the thumb in a day, right? So that is the frequency. That means the number of times the habit is doing. D is the duration. That means amount of time the habit, the child is having the habit or the individual is having the habit. So the amount of time spent in indulging the habit. So that is the duration. The third one is our intensity. Intensity. So intensity is the with which the habit is performed. So thumb sucking habit is, see this thumb sucking habit is when a child is going to suck the thumb. So that this habit we call it thumb sucking habit. And if the child is doing after 3.5 to 4 years, that means this habit is not normal. This is a paranormal habit. So there are some effects which we see in the alveodento-alveolar complex. So what are the effects of thumb sucking? In order to understand the effects of thumb sucking, you need to imagine that you are sucking a thumb. So what happens when you are sucking a thumb? So this thumb is going to create the pressure, outward pressure on the maxillary anterior and inward pressure on the mandibular anterior. And because of this pressure, there is going to be the labial tipping of the maxillary anterior teeth. And this labial tipping of the maxillary anterior teeth will result in the proclination of the maxillary anteriors. And because of this proclination of maxillary anteriors, there is going to be increase in the overjet. And some children rest their hand on the mandibular anterior while sucking. So in that case, the child may develop the lingual tipping of the mandibular incisor also. So the lingual tipping of the mandibular incisors also. And we also see anterior open bite because all the time there is a thumb which is inside the child's mouth, right? So there can be anterior open bite. And it can result in the restriction of the incisor eruption, or there can be supra eruption of the incisors, or there can be supra eruption of the molars. So the cheek muscles, they contract while the child is sucking the thumb because inside there is a pressure which is developed. And because of that, the maxilla becomes narrow. So the narrow maxillary arches. And because of this narrow maxillary arches, there can be posterior cross bite. And because of this thumb sucking habit, there can be also associated a tongue thrusting habit. So that will also result in the open bite. And the upper lip becomes hypotonic because not function. While on the other hand, the lower lip, because of the lower lip, there can be the hyperactive mentalis activity. Right. So Dunlop, he gave a theory which is known as the beta hypothesis. And this beta hypothesis, it is useful to break the habit. Because what Dunlop says that if a child is asked to sit in front of a mirror and if we ask the patient to suck the thumb and if he observes doing himself, then he is going to leave the habit. So there can be a break in the habit, and that break is due to the consciousness of the child. So that is a Dunlop hypothesis, or we can say the beta hypothesis. So guys, what is the treatment? Management for the thumb sucking habit. So we can also give some appliances like this is a palatal crib. In the palate you can see there is a crib so that the child is not sucking the thumb, right? Also we can give appliance such as the bluegrass appliance. So bluegrass appliance. and there can be psychological management also, or in the home remedy, if a child, if the parents are not ready for the appliances, or in the home also, we can ask the parents to put some bitter substances on the thumb. So that can be fumite, that can be quinine. So that is not used, that can be asafoetida, that is our hing, or it can be pepper, so that the child is not sucking the thumb, right? So let's revise once again. The thumb sucking habit is normal up to 3.5 to 4 years, but after 4 years, if it develop into thumb sucking habit. So the effect is the proclination of the maxillary anterior teeth, increase in the overjet, and open bite, anterior open bite, which is usually seen, narrow maxillary arch. There can be lingual tipping of the mandibular incisor also, and hyperactive mentalis activity. So next one we have is the tongue thirsting. So tongue thirst habit. So this is a condition wherein during the swallowing, the tongue is going to contact the anterior teeth. As you can see here, during swallowing, the tongue is contacting the anterior teeth. So this is a tongue thirst. It can be of two types. It can be a simple tongue thirst, or it can be a complex tongue thirst. So guys, what are the clinical features for tongue thirsting? Proclination of anterior teeth, because the tongue is coming in between, so there can be proclination of anterior teeth. And the same reason for the anterior open bite, again anterior open bite, proclination of anterior teeth, we have seen in thumb sucking habit also. And we also see bimaxillary protrusion. If you remember, we have covered bimaxillary protrusion. So bimaxillary protrusion is wherein there is a proclination of the anterior teeth, but molar relation is class 1 molar relation protrusion. Also we see posterior open bite in case of lateral tongue thirst. See, in case of, if there is a frontal tongue thirst like this, if there is, it is present in the frontal region, then there is going to be anterior open bite. If the child is taking the tongue laterally, that is the lateral tongue thirst, there can be posterior open bite, or there can be posterior cross bite. Right. So we have studied tongue thirsting. Two types are there. One is the simple, another one is the complex. Let's have a look at both of them. So simple tongue thirst and the complex tongue thirst. So the simple tongue thirst is wherein there is a normal tooth contact while swallowing. But in case of a complex tongue thirst, when the patient or when the child is swallowing, the teeth gets apart. These both are at the swallowing, right? Then we see that there is an anterior open bite which is present in the simple tongue thirst. In case of complex tongue thirst, we see the anterior open bite can be absent. Open bite can be absent or can be diffuse. So in case of simple tongue thirst, there is a good intercuspation of the teeth. That means a good cusp fossa relationship. Cuspation of the teeth. In case of complex tongue thirst, we see the occlusion is poor. Then in simple tongue thirst, ड्यूरिंग स्वालोइंग द टंग इज बिकॉज द चाइल्ड इज थर्स्टिंग द टंग सो द चाइल्ड इज टेकिंग द टंग फॉरवर्ड सो देयर कैन बी एंटीरियर लिप सील ड्यूरिंग स्वालोइंग सो एंड ऑल्सो वी सी एबनॉर्मल mentalis activity. But in case of a complex tongue thirst, we see there is a absence of temporalis muscle contraction, constriction. And also there is a contraction of circumoral muscles. So all the muscles surrounding the mouth. During the swallowing. So this is the difference between the simple and the complex tongue thirst. Now talking about the management of tongue thirst. So, we give appliances, removable and the fixed habit breaking appliances. And also, we ask the patient to perform the exercises, tongue exercises. Now guys, talking about the last habit, which is our mouth breathing habit. Mouth breathing is a simple habit wherein instead of nose, a person start breathing from the mouth. So a mouth breathing habit can be obstructive because of the obstruction. So obstruction can be due to the deviated nasal septum. Any tumor it can be, or there can be nasal polyps. Or there can be habitual mouth breathing and anatomical mouth breathing also we see. Due to the short upper lip. So what are the features? First of all, this is associated with something known as the long face syndrome or the classical adenoid faces. Right. So what are the features? There is going to be long and narrow face. Narrow nose and narrow nasal passage. Right, then we see the upper lip is short. See, these are the reasons, these are the causes. Upper lip, short and flaccid. We see that there is contracted upper arch. And because of that, there can be a posterior cross bite. We see expressionless face. Or blank face. Also we see there is increase in the overjet. And this can result in the flaring of the anterior teeth, incisors. So very important feature is anterior marginal gingivitis. Anterior marginal gingivitis, and the reason for this is due to the drying of the gingiva. We see because of the drying of the gingiva, drying of the mouth, because see the child is starting taking breaths from the mouth. So there is a drying of the oral mucosa, there is drying of the oral cavity. Because of that, there can be increase in the caries. Because of the lack of saliva, there can be in anterior marginal gingivitis. Because of the drying of the gingiva, right? So also there can be anterior open bite, which can be also seen. So how do we diagnose? There are some tests. The test can be the rhinomanometry. So this is the study of the airflow. Study of the nasal airflow study. So this device tells us the flow of the air through the nasal passage and if there is how much the nasal resistance is there, right? So that can be told by this. So what is the treatment for mouth breathing? If the reason is etiology, always we have to treat the etiology. So if the etiology is due to the obstruction, we have to remove either the nasal obstruction is there or pharyngeal obstruction is there, we have to remove it via the surgical procedure. So we have to refer it to the ENT. Also, mouth breathing habit can be treated using vestibular screen. And we know that there is a constricted upper arch, right? We have talked about this constricted upper arch. This one, constricted upper arch. Because there is a constricted upper arch, narrow upper arch, so we can give rapid maxillary expansion. So this is going to expand the palate, so widen the palate. So if there is any posterior cross bite because of the constricted upper arch, so that can also be treated using the RME. So guys, let's quickly run through the etiology of the malocclusion. So the etiology can be supernumerary teeth. Supernumerary teeth, we know that these are the extra teeth. Super means extra, numerary means in number. So extra in number. If there are extra number of teeth present in the mouth, what will happen to the rest of the teeth? There is going to be crowding. There can be rotations. Very easy, rotation of the adjacent teeth. What if there is a missing teeth present? Missing teeth is more common than the supernumerary teeth. If there is a missing teeth present, that means there is a space which is created. So spacing is present in the dental arch. And what happens? The teeth adjacent to the space, suppose this is the mandibular arch, okay? And the space which is present, suppose if there is a space which is present, there is going to be the mesial migration. So this molar will start differing mesially. So the adjacent teeth can migrate also. So because of the spacing, there can be the adjacent teeth migrate and can cause the abnormal location of the axial inclination of the teeth. So absence of the permanent teeth can result in over retained deciduous teeth. So if there is any absent permanent teeth, it can result in the over retained deciduous teeth. Suppose in case of there is an abnormal labial frenum which is present. This is a very important point. Suppose if there is an abnormal frenum which is present. So that is going to cause, we know that midline diastema. Because, see, this frenum is present between the two central incisors, right? So it is going to present like this. And if there is an abnormal labial frenum which is present, it is going to prevent both of these tooth to contact. So there is a space which is created because this frenum is going to interfere. It will not let the central maxillary to central incisor approximate to each other. So how do we diagnose this? We diagnose this via a Blanch test. So Blanch test is positive in case of abnormal labial frenum. How do we do it? We stretch the upper lip for some time, and if there is a blanching which is positive, so in the Blanch test, as the name suggests, there is going to be a positive blanching. So if blanching is present in the interdental papillary area, interdental papilla, then that means the Blanch test is positive. So in the patient with a midline diastema, how do we treat it? Very important, very important. How do we treat it? The first thing which we do is we close the space orthodontically. Close the space orthodontically. And then the second thing is the frenectomy procedure. This frenectomy, it is going to form a scar tissue, and if it is done early, it is going to prevent the closure of the space. So that is the reason frenectomy we do it later on. The first thing we do is we close the space. Now we are going to talk two important points. One is if there is a premature loss of deciduous teeth, and another one we'll talk about if there is a prolonged retention of deciduous teeth. So if there is a premature loss of deciduous teeth, what will happen? That means the permanent, see, if there is a premature loss, that means the deciduous tooth have fallen prior to its own time. So there is a space which is created, and if there is early loss of deciduous teeth, it can result in the migration of the adjacent teeth, because there is a space. So migration of the adjacent teeth into the space, and it will prevent the eruption of the permanent successors. That means the permanent teeth which was supposed to be erupting in that particular space cannot come because there is no space left for that permanent teeth. So suppose if there is loss of E, that means loss of deciduous second molar. This loss of deciduous second molar can cause the forward shifting of the permanent first molar. So there can be a shifting of 6. And because of this shifting, it can block the path for the erupting 5. So by blocking the eruption of the second molar, it can see this this 5, it can be either impacted or it can erupt to abnormal location, to abnormal position. So it can deflect its path. One is the premature loss. If there is a premature loss of deciduous teeth, another one is when there is a prolonged retention of the primary teeth, deciduous teeth. See, if these teeth are not, if there is a prolonged retention, there is not exfoliation of the primary teeth, what will happen? This is going to prevent the normal eruption of the again permanent teeth. So if there is a prolonged retention of anterior teeth, can result in the lingual or the palatal eruption of their permanent successors. If there is prolonged retention of the posterior teeth or prolonged retention of the buccal teeth, it can result in the eruption of the permanent teeth either buccally or lingually. Or there can be impacted also within the jaw. They may not erupt. So this is the prolonged retention of the deciduous teeth. What if there is an abnormal path of eruption? Abnormal eruptive path. This can be due to arch length deficiency, due to presence of any extra teeth, which is the supernumerary teeth, or if there are retained root fragments which are present, or there can be any formation of a bony barrier which is not letting the tooth erupt. So the most common is the maxillary canine. So this maxillary canine is almost near to the, close to the floor of the orbit, and travel down to their final position in the oral cavity. And this is the reason that it is the most common, most often it erupts in the abnormal position. So the abnormal eruptive path, the tooth which follows, is the most common, is the maxillary canine. Last one in the today's topic is the ankylosis. So ankylosis is wherein the tooth is fused with the bone. So if there is lack of PDL, there can be absence of PDL. So this tooth is directly fused to the bone, because there is no PDL, tooth is fused to the bone. So in that case, the reason can be trauma also. So in that case, clinically the tooth is not erupting to the normal level. So that will be called as submerged teeth. Submerged means tooth is not fully erupted. And the most common submerged teeth is the mandibular E, and you can remember it, ME, mandibular E. So this is the most common submerged teeth. So guys, this finishes this part of the malocclusion of the Express Revision course. I hope that you have enjoyed the video. If you have enjoyed the video, why don't you give it a thumbs up? Also, you can comment in the comment section below. There is a link in the description box below which will directly take you to the notes of this particular lecture. You don't have to take down notes now. And also, you can support us via Paytm as well as on PayPal. So guys, till then, keep reading, keep learning, stay motivated, and I'll see you soon in the next video.